Today on the Dear Bamf podcast, we welcome Nairi Hourdajian. She is the Chief Marketing Officer, the CMO at Canaan, which is a large, significant VC fund located up in the Bay Area. She also was part of Uber's communication team for quite a few years, and some of her past clients include working with Joe Biden. We're super excited to have her here today. Nairi Hourdajian, I'm so excited to have you here. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me. Thrilled to be with you.
Yes, we're going to dive right in. I already gave you guys a little scoop on how freaking badass she is. So let's just kick it off, if that sounds good with you.
Sounds great.
Okay, first, let's start off with a kind of easier one here. Let's see. Is it appropriate? Oh, Dear Bamf. I always forget that part. Dear Bamf, is it appropriate to chat with our clients about their plan, what their plan is in post-pandemic state? That question might be hard to answer right now, which makes sense. But should we be asking if they have a rebound plan in place? What would you say?
Well, if you back up a minute and think about the most successful client engagements, it's the ones mm-hmm. where you really have the trust to be on the inside, where mm-hmm. the consultant is considered a true extension of the team and where there isn't any sort of hesitation to bring those consultants into the fold. And so, you know, hopefully that's the kind of relationship you have with your client, in which case I would say absolutely. You know, I would be positioning that line of questioning more around the health of the business without going first to the future of the engagement, just so that you can really get on the same page. But also mm-hmm. make the case, because it's true, that you can best serve them with maximum information and visibility. You can even be thinking about some positioning now that will support them with any sort of like changes in plans or pivots down the road. And who knows, there may be some projects that you can take on that are slightly different in scope than what is written into your contract in support of any future rebound plans. At the same time, companies have their hands full. Executives don't have a lot of extra time or patience to spend on non-essential items. Mm-hmm, so, mm-hmm. you know, I'll always be diplomatic, but I absolutely think it's a fair line of questioning. And, you know, again, the best engagements are the ones where there's mutual trust on both sides.
Mm-hmm. Have you been seeing this at all of a discussion point at your fund by chance?
With regard to portfolio companies, you mean?
Yes, yes.
Well, you know, we're very hands-on investors, and so we're very much in the tent. Our folks are obviously on the board, but we like to be the first call when something great is happening and the first call when something not as great is happening. And so in mm-hmm. general, you know, we have great visibility into what's going on at our portfolio companies. And I think that the onus really is on executives right now. And it's really been heartening to see even the ones going through some tough times doing a great job at this in our portfolio, you know, being as transparent as possible with the team. And going back mm-hmm. to the question, I mean, consultants are an extension of the team. And the only thing an executive team or a CEO or a founder can do is communicate what they know. At this point, they don't know everything. There's absolutely no way.
That's true.
And so just being as transparent as possible, you know, with the necessary limits, can really set the team off on the right track during this period of uncertainty.
Same thing that we've seen is the transparency has gone up, you know, twofold, threefold for a lot of folks, ourselves included, with just how we will even forward emails from, you know, regardless if it's from PPP status or update or where something is with a particular client. It's just, it's a good time to allow for that detail to come out, I think.
100%. And, you know, there's never been a better time to, you know, shift the way you engage with the people you work with, whether, again, mm-hmm. a CEO or, you know, running your agency or your client engagement team. I mean, nobody has the answers. Showing vulnerability is okay. And that's true, again, bidirectionally between client and consultant as well. And so mm-hmm. there are some great examples of executive leadership out there that have really stepped up to the plate, been willing to show that vulnerability, be transparent about why they made the decisions they did, why they were forced to make the decisions that they did. And, you know, you can't put a bow around some of those things. And so just being real is the fastest way to reach your goals.
Yeah. Agreed. Okay. I've seen this question before, so let me hear what you're going to say about it, Nairi. Here's the next one. Dear Bamf, My client constantly asks why they aren't being included in top-tier coverage, but they aren't willing to give us access to customers or company data that would set them apart from competitors in the space. And by the way, they say, oh, this is a B2B type of company. What should our next strategic move be for this client?
Come to Jesus party.
I love the come to Jesus. Yes. So what's your come to Jesus sound like? And you, by the way, used to be at Uber, so I'm sure you had some of those moments.
Sure. I think I have a lot more of them now, actually, because I work with very late-stage companies that the media landscape has changed a lot. Securing top-tier coverage for tech companies at different stages with varying degrees of success, with varying degrees of existing profile, is no small feat. And so, you know, setting that understanding at the outset, I mean, I would say even the pitch process about what's realistic and what isn't, again, so that everybody's aligned on what isn't feasible. Now, in the specifics of this particular question, I would say, what's in it for the journalist? Have your client pretend that they're a reporter. You know, make sure they understand what a reporter's job actually is, because there's a lot of misperception about what that is. A reporter's job is not to write a puffy story about a company. It's to find a story, unearth a story. Yes, sure, folks working with media can help them to point out an idea of a story that maybe they hadn't come across yet. But have your client play the journalist and try to figure out, you know, what's the gristle here? What makes this interesting? Where's the tension? The more you can push them to serve up those components, the more successful they'll be. And, you know, it just doesn't happen magically. And at the end of the day, you know, press may not be the right channel for them.
That's true. There's another thing.
Tell your own story. You just got to weigh the likelihood of success across those different channels and meeting the business goals, depending what they are.
I love, and I have not heard this before, of putting the onus back on the client or whoever your internal contact is with this pressure. Let's think like a journalist. How do you think a journalist does their job? Because then you could really get to the root of, wow, do they really have a total misperception?
Yes.
Because to your point, it is not their job to talk in any positive light about your company. It's not.
Exactly.
In fact, that's absolutely not their job. It's to be neutral and get all sides of the story and speak accordingly to what is the truth.
Exactly. I think there's so much misperception about what a reporter's day looks like and their own challenges are. I was recently suggesting a candidate to another venture fund who is currently a journalist thinking about switching into venture. And this other venture fund was like, I don't know. I mean, do you think a journalist could roll with like without this sort of like freelance, easygoing schedule? You know, we're really hardcore at this fund. And I said, excuse me. And I said to him, do you have any idea what a journalist's day-to-day looks like? What the pressure cooker of a newsroom feels like? Feels like to be in a super competitive industry where your peers' success at other outlets is in your face and public every single day. Not to mention that any pressure that a company feels to manage a story externally, you know, the journalist is feeling the same pressure on their end.
Yeah.
I actually think it's a super high pressure environment, and it's really, really important for anyone doing work with the press to understand that.
Yeah. And that's the perfect example of showcasing how folks don't know what it really is to be a journalist.
At all.
And the structure of that job, plus the pressure and how public it is, to your point. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Oh, well, I hope that journalist gets that job at a fund. They'll probably think it's a cakewalk, given the other circumstances. All right. Next question here. Here we go. This is a long one. Dear Banff, I've been working with one of my clients for nearly a year, and I'm having trouble level setting with the CEO around the type of media coverage we are able to get with the assets we have. This is similar to the other question.
Mm-hmm.
The company sells a consumer tech product that was initially launched 6+ years ago. At the time, the product was featured in the Wall Street Journal. The company has a minimal marketing budget with no extra funds for professional videos or third-party research reports. The news moments we have are focused around new software features or capabilities, and the CEO is dead set on us landing feature stories at the caliber of the Wall Street Journal article he once had. Where have we heard this before, Nairi?
Everywhere.
My team has explained how the media landscape has shifted since then, And we brainstormed ideas for other assets we can gather to help us land larger stories. Yet the budget's constraints have gotten in our way. Do you have advice on how to level set with the CEO and work around the roadblocks we are up against to getting larger stories in national press outlets?
Yeah, well, first, you know, again, this comes up so many times with earlier stage companies in particular.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things that I think is most misunderstood about pitching media is how essential the match is between story and reporter. And, you know, really taking the time, to understand a reporter's psychology and interests and where they've covered things before, what kind of story angles are going to land with them, or, you know, they have bosses too. They're trying to show to their bosses that they're doing interesting, original reporting and work. So, you know, understanding that they're not going to be a parrot or a archaic, you know, uninteresting press release. So anyway, thinking about the match, thinking about a small handful of reporters who could be long-term targets, and just making sure you're building those relationships. I know that sounds so basic, but I often think that one of the most misunderstood pieces of doing strong communications work by executives is this idea of relationship building when there is no story on the other end of that coffee or that meeting or now that video call. And so I'm a little bit blending the idea of roadblocks and how to communicate with the CEO. But I would say, like, one of the ways to get around that roadblock is don't pitch a reporter. Pitch a reporter to take a meeting, just to learn more.
Yeah, just get that.
Is what you're going to bring to the table. It's a much easier piece of outreach. And then also, you know, you be upfront with the CEO that you're going to spend your time, you're going to do this, you're going to do five of these, and there may be no stories on the other side of this for 6 months. And that just is what it is. It is well worth the time. The metaphor I like to use is you would never reach out. This is a consumer tech company. I have no idea what kind of consumer tech product, but let's say they wanted to get acquired by Amazon.
Yeah.
Would they call Amazon when they're ready for acquisition and talk to them for the first time? Never.
No.
Never. That is a relationship that you build over time. The same is absolutely true for reporters. So it's a little bit of a combination answer. You know, it a little bit goes back to what we talked about before in the other question, which is just, you know, have them put on their hat and figure out what's interesting. I actually don't think that the budget is as big of a problem if it's really earned media that they're looking for. I actually think that's not an issue at all. So I would just think it's all about figuring out what data, news hook, trends, you know, it's consumer tech product. What are the shifts in consumer behavior they're observing, and how is that at all relevant or important to society in light of the current pandemic? Just thinking through a little bit more of those angles. And it sounds like maybe there isn't enough sort of opening of the kimono potentially around some of those aspects. And so that would be what to push on for the CEO, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. I love the idea of getting a win, which doesn't sometimes mean, oh my gosh, a top tier media placement. That sometimes is just not feasible. But getting a win can mean, hey, we got those meetings, those coffees, those virtual meetings for X number of outlets, and the conversation was had. Those are wins.
And then you're building a relationship, and they may be writing a story that has nothing to do with this company, but hey, you guys touched on another topic in that coffee meeting or that get to know you meeting, and the reporter thinks, oh, that might be a good, you know, person to quote in my story. And then it grows from there.
Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, this further goes to just the education expectation setting, what you said, come to Jesus meeting with this person. We've had a client, for example, that had the dead on understanding of exactly the situation where they know they didn't have a story. They had some really incredible work, but it's hard to explain, et cetera, and so forth. And they signed up for a year with us. We're still working with them because they knew, like, okay, these are only the top tier outlets that we want to get, but we know it's going to take a lot of time because we got to start with the relationships. And it was like, oh, what a perfect golden client.
How refreshing.
We didn't have to educate. It was amazing. Like, we love these guys. And it was like, wow, like, this client gets it. And they're a bit in the media space, so they kind of know that. But that was just wonderful because they got it. And it's going to take 12 months to just get those pieces eventually done. And we have. But it took quite a few months just to get the conversation, just to book the coffees, the digital coffees, all that stuff. It was exactly to your playbook of, yeah, just get those relationships going and you'll see them trickle out and play out. Something will happen.
Exactly. I mean, I would spend money, time, effort, whatever the variable is on that much more than doing some sort of like news hijacking pitching that's just going to, you know, land with a thud.
Mm-hmm. So true.
The other thing too is this is a consumer tech product, so it's not the perfect category, but
yeah,
if you really go back to first principles and what is the goal we're trying to accomplish here, is it because everybody else is getting press in my category and I just want it? Or is there like particular business goals? And then if you start there,
yeah, what's the why? What's the why?
Yeah, what's the why? And then you can figure out the what that gets you there, right? Because then you can understand if maybe some random trade press that you hadn't ever thought about before can actually reach your audience. Who are you trying to reach and why? What's the timing? Did this CEO see consumer adoption after that Wall Street Journal story? I kind of doubt it, but you know, it would be interesting to know. What is the goal here of getting more top-tier media coverage?
Mm-hmm, exactly. Sometimes when you try to get to that why, things pop up. Like, well, really the why for you is that you just missed that attention.
Yeah.
You missed your friends commenting and talking about it and sending it to your mom.
Right.
I'm serious. Like, no. I'm sorry. We've seen that before.
100%.
So it really didn't have a business objective. It just made you feel good. Okay. But then let's be real about that. And let's not do that because it has no business objective. So yeah, there you go. All right, next question here. Here we go. Dear Banff, my executive is the public face of our company, so he handles all interviews that come our way. He's extremely friendly and a great storyteller. The one problem, he refuses to go through media training, and he needs it. He's great at connecting with people, but is not very succinct and can be all over the place when answering what should be a simple question. How do you suggest preparing him for interviews, given that he doesn't want to sit for a formal media training?
Yes. Well.
Does it sound familiar?
No comment. I think there's some sort of like a press article out there about an experience I may or may not have gone through. It's a similar.
Okay. Yep. Yep.
But anyway, what I was going to say is I would just reframe the conversation. So don't call it media training. Don't bring in an outsider. It sounds like this person does a fair amount of press already. And so do, you know, hopefully he's or she is a data-driven executive. And so take a look back at the last 5 to 10 clips that came out of the interviews and highlight the messages that were the goals to get through. I'm willing to bet if this person's not a disciplined message deliverer, there are not going to be as many highlights as you need or want in one of those stories. It's just a very visual way for people to understand they're not getting the job done. You know, that's one way. You know, look at, you know, show, you could do some sort of like a comparison of the average quote length in a story and then sort of the prattling on that has gone on in the last conversation this person had. And so just show rather than tell can be an effective way to do
yes.
that.
Yes.
Label it something other than media training. Make sure that you're doing mock interview prep yourself for this executive before they go out, you know, record, playback, you know, the whole deal. Mm-hmm. Call it like a prep session.
So sounds like, yeah, give it a relabel, repackage it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Easy to do that. And then go to the data, go to the information that already has been conveyed and see, did you get that quote? Did you land it? Did you? And so on and so forth. Now, unfortunately, you can't listen to the interviews of other people quoted and stuff. But what you can do is retroactively go back. And what I'd even suggest in this case, because we've seen this before, is make sure that you record that interview so that then you can have that feedback session. And unfortunately, you can't just say, oh, well, on that point, you had this point and you sounded like, if you don't have the actual go to the tape, like let's listen to it, it's hard for people to get it because they heard it a different way. Or if they're the one speaking at that point, they're not listening to how they're talking. You know, they're just trying to answer the question or thinking of their next thing or something. So in other words, the reality of how it's being conveyed or what they're missing is not always as easy to pinpoint
if you don't have something to point back to. So if you can, with this particular CEO, say, okay, great, you know what, no media training, or we're not going to repackage it. Great. Well, you know what, I'm going to sit on the call and I'm just going to take it and just like, let's record it, assuming the reporter is okay with that. We'll just do that. And then we can have a rehash, you know, afterwards and see like, hey, how can we improve? Hopefully you have a CEO who's open to and not so egotistical as being open to wanting to improve.
Absolutely. You know, recording is a no-brainer. One of the things that's also can be effective, it's a great point, is take that recording and actually transcribe it. Because once
Yes.
someone has to read the verbatim of what has come out of their mouths, it hits home a lot more clearly.
Oh, it does.
Because all of the ums and the equivocation and the buying of time is in black and white.
Oh, yes. We used to do something. We haven't done it in a long time because now we record everything. But we used to do what we call camp, call camp here. And people hated it, which was the point, which was, yeah, you record these client calls and then you listen back to it. You listen to yourself and you pinpoint and pick out all the times you said or whatever your filler word is, or when you answered a question for 4 minutes when really it was a 20-second answer, et cetera, et cetera. Oh, it's illuminating.
Oh, I love that. I had not heard for internal sort of improvement.
Oh, yes.
Love that.
Take that. Steal that. Yes. For agency people, especially for younger people, maybe they haven't been or led calls so much, but even forget that, even older people, because we all have our tics and our things that we need to work on. And it's so funny to see the array of what filler words are out there for all of us. Mm-hmm. Some people have more of the thing. Some of them do. We had one gal here who did a okay response. Did you just listen to yourself? You said okay 17 times on that call. And she's like, oh my God, you know, because then you can listen to it and you're like, oh my God, you're right. Right. So it's quite illuminating, the playback on the call camp.
One of the other things that I find effective with these types of CEOs is just to remind them that everyone they see out there that they so admire is preparing and is preparing rigorously. I had the immense pleasure of working with a woman named Dee Dee Myers, who was President Clinton's press secretary at the White House.
Amazing.
And, she faced the media every day on live television at the podium. And, you know, it was all the things you expect it to be. Mm-hmm. Contentious, challenging, you get pushed. It's all on television. It's on radio. It goes into print. She was so practiced at it and had done it for so long. When I worked with her, you know, several years later, she would go on TV frequently on the Sunday shows in particular. And she prepped. Every single time. One wouldn't think that Dee Dee Myers would need to, because she's brilliant and had been so practiced in facing the media every day. But she did. Do you know why? Because the best people always do. The people who are on TV all the time are always practicing and they're taking it super seriously.
Yes.
And so I think it's always helpful to remind people that people aren't just getting out there and winging it. They're putting the time in.
No, they're not.
It always shows.
Yes. So true. So maybe that for the person who wrote in, up the practice, get it practiced. Love it. Oh, maybe the last thing for that is just to ask the CEO too, hey, who's someone you admire that just speaks so eloquently that you really look up to, who seems like that flawless speaker? Oh, okay. It's insert so-and-so. Okay. Let's get you to that level. How are we going to do that? Well, we're going to practice. We're going to review every tape. We're going to blah, blah, blah. So then it takes the onus off of, you're not doing a good job and you're messing up. Mm-hmm. Let's get you to, you know, that standard that I expect you, and more to like the aspirational, like, we want you to be this all-star order mm-hmm. that you said is your icon. Mm-hmm. That let's get you to that.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. That's a little bit more positive of the spin.
Totally. And depending on the organization, if there are other executives out there as spokespeople, a little healthy competition there.
That's right. I love that too. Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's move to our final question here. Here we go. Another pandemic one. Dear Banff, with the current pandemic, it seems really important to continue building a strong personal relationship with our clients. What's the best way to do that without crossing professional boundaries, but still show that they can rely on us in a more personal way? Is it possible to have a client PR relationship that isn't all business all the time?
Yeah,
I'm kind of a on that too. I'm like, don't show up in your bathrobe on the Zoom call.
Right.
I don't think we're talking about that.
Right. Yeah, look, I think no question, it's an important time to fortify those relationships. And the best way to do that is to deliver that sort of tailwind of support that they didn't even realize they needed until you showed up, right? The best thing that a client can feel is that you got there before they even realized they needed something. And so thinking about what they're facing on a day-to-day basis, again, hinges on the ability to see into the organization with sufficient clarity. But assuming that's the case, you know, trying to peer into the organization and think what could support them. I actually think about it less from a personal standpoint, but, you know, maybe that's my biases, just to keep it primarily professional. That being said, the best teams the teams that work best together do connect in a personal way at some points or other. You know, depending on what the kickoff was like for this engagement, you could do a bit of a reset, you know, in a COVID world and bring some vulnerability exercises into that session so that you can really connect in a different way. You know, I wonder if the question, though, isn't sort of geared in the wrong direction, trying to maybe tackle the problem of maybe not feeling like the relationship is gelling. And so I would think about, you know, what the source of the concern is and go from there.
Yeah, a little confusing on this one because, you know, more personal way. And I'm going, huh, you know, but more so, I think at this time, people want help with solutions, people that can handle and execute and take care of something. Because we don't need more, no executive right now is like, oh, great, something else for me to handhold, something else for me to monitor and make sure and see if you're okay. Like if you're solution oriented and you could provide the solution and execute the solution, that's going to be solid gold for your relationship.
Nope.
So I'm thinking more on the focus of that.
Yep.
Maybe it's cool, you know, their dog's name or whatever, or their, you know, that, great. But I would say just a caution as a final note for this person is not to overextend that where you're going to ask about their dog every single time you get on the call when really you haven't done a good job on executing the campaign, let's say, that you're trying to do. That only goes so far. So watch out for trying to make it too personal or like, let's just talk about insert your dog or your favorite thing or the weather or something stupid for a period of time when actually you don't have enough to really bolster that with because the actual work you're trying to do hasn't been done or hasn't been executed. Do you know what I mean? Like there's no sugarcoating of, we don't have really a relationship here because the primary one of why you're here on a professional level is not actually that good.
Right. Absolutely. And I think that there is a real opportunity for this person and this consultant team to say to their client, look, we know this is a rough time. Maybe this company has had to let some people go. Think of us as an extension of you and your executive team, the behind the scenes people. You need help writing that internal email. We are here for you. Don't think about us exclusively in the scope that we had talked about when we kicked off. It's incredibly lonely to be at the top of an organization going through a tumultuous time.
Yeah.
And there are very few people that those leaders feel they can authentically, you know, run ideas by or talk to. And so I think the goal would be to become one of those advisors, but I agree with you very much that you don't get there by, you know, shortcutting through, you know, personal.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that's it, Nairi. We've solved everything.
Perfect. Amazing. We should do this more often.
Oh, there will be more questions, definitely next time, of course. But thank you for being on. I'm glad also you're safe, you're sound amid everything going on.
Thank you. Like
saving the world. from good spots. And hey, your kids didn't come in and pop into this whole webinar or this whole podcast taping. So yay, wins all around.
I think this is the first time that hasn't happened in a long time.
Amazing. Look at that.
Thanks so much for having me on. And kudos to you for, you know, putting some content out there that really elevates the best work that this profession does. So thank you.
Agreed.
Thanks for listening to Dear Banff, the advice podcast for PR and marketing pros like you. Our show was created by BAM, a PR and marketing agency headquartered in San Diego and New York City. Our music was composed by Tiffany Dizon, played by San Diego Symphony's Art of the Lawn, and produced by Daniel Kostner. Our podcast was produced by Citizen Recording. If you have a hairy PR or marketing question you'd like us to answer, write to us by going to www.bamcommunications.biz/DearBanff. Don't forget the F. We'll be back next Monday with another episode of Dear Banff. Until then.